sadness have also been reported. In depressed patients, worsening depression, including risk of suicide, may occur. Alcohol may increase these risks. Side effects include next-day drowsiness.
Pharmaceutical industry looks at the destination that it wants to fix and ignores the fact that when you add a drug, there are multiple drug interactions, which are not side effects, but direct effects.
So we have that, and then we have to look at the efficacy, right? Do these meds actually work? Could those risks be worth it? And that evidence is really even more concerning because we have a body of evidence that suggests that these medications are no better than a placebo. SIBO, of course, which wouldn't incur, you know, those same risks. And then there's the bigger question of what are you opting out of when you choose to manage your symptoms in this way? You know, there's a story I really love, which, you know, talks about a caterpillar that's in the chrysalis, right? And it's struggling to get out. And there's this little hole in the chrysalis and there's a man nearby and he sort of feels bad for the caterpillar. It's, you know, it's trying to get out, right? So he takes a pair of scissors and he snips the chrysalis. And of course, the caterpillar turns into a butterfly that dies, that never can fly, right? Because it needs to go through the process of emergence and struggle, literally. It physically needs to do that to be able to manifest.
You know, I've really taken to Dr. Emerson's protocols.
The nutrition?
It's really helping. And he's really good about keeping in communication, even though he's in Hawaii.
The numbers are outstanding. I mean, it's, you know, unbelievable. It's only been 8 weeks that you've been on the program, and it's phenomenal.
So this last two flare-ups, I haven't had the joint pains since I started the nutrition. Because that's the biggest thing is, I mean, I can't even, you know, go up and down the stairs to my bedroom. I have to, like, stay downstairs, sleep downstairs.
Well, here we are. We are about to go get a sound healing from Dr. Jeffrey Thompson.
I'm putting these wrist sensors on her wrist. This is just to hold them in place. These wrist sensors are connected to this laptop over here. It's got a little sensor. It's collecting the electrical information from your heart. As the sound sweeps into the correct range for her body, we'll see her nervous system beginning to respond. And when it hits this spot, I'm going to make a cue mark on my program here so I can identify what frequency we need to use.
We use very precisely tuned sound frequencies for healing. My innovation is to expose the body to these precisely tuned sound waves until I find a sound wave that makes the sympathetic nervous system push in the clutch. Here we go, it's getting there. Getting really close. That's it right there. But that's what we're looking for is zero. Zero stress in the autonomic nervous system or homeostasis. Now, normally I would expect it to look like this, where it comes down, hits that point, and then goes off into parasympathetic, the green. But hers didn't do that. She hit the point, but she went back into this stress response again. It means that she's had this chronic stress condition for a long time. And when it begins to respond to the sound waves and it starts to push in the clutch, it took a little bit of extra time to get there. But once it did get there, it wasn't able to completely cross over and go into the relaxation phase, which is what parasympathetic nervous system is, the relaxation response, because her nervous system is still too worried to go there, to completely let go. So people ask me, what kind of conditions can you heal with this? And my answer at this point is anything that has stress as its cause. And as far as I'm concerned, that's pretty much everything. Welcome back.
Wow.
It's the first words out of everybody's mouth.
Yeah.
It's wow. Okay, here we go.
What Dr. Thompson showed me is that Eva is in a constant state of stress. Even when she's relaxing, it's hard for her to fully switch over into the parasympathetic nervous system, which is where you need to be if you want to heal. So that just proves to me that healing really needs to take place on multiple levels. When it comes to stress, the tool that's absolutely changed my life, and I know millions of others, is meditation.
Meditation has been around for thousands of years. The mind is yapping all the time, and it's telling us generally scary and limiting things. The mind is wonderful when you're using it as a tool. It's not so great when it's calling the shots. In the very first research on meditation, done by a mentor of mine, Dr. Herbert Benson, he said, well, it shuts down the fight or flight response, the fear response, and it stimulates the parasympathetic or relaxing nervous system of the body. And that's what heals. So at the very most basic level, meditation relieves stress.
If you wake up in the morning, you take a shower, you take a bath, because you don't want to take yesterday's dirt with you out into the day. But if I wake up in the morning and I immediately go to television or radio or the computer or newspaper, and I'm taking in all the stress of the world, then I might cleanse my body, but my mind is carrying so much stress. So that's why meditating in the morning is as important as taking a bath, purifying your mind, purifying your consciousness.
There are many kinds of meditation. There are meditations that involve self-reflection. So you sit quietly and you ask yourself, who am I? There are forms of meditation that are called self-questioning, which is questioning your beliefs. A third form of meditation is what is these days called mindfulness, which is a terrible word because you're not using your mind when you're practicing awareness. The awareness of a thought is not a thought. Then there is what is called transcendence, which is usually using a technique like a mantra. The mantra is kind of a sound that competes with your thoughts and ultimately takes you to a place where there is no thought and no mantra, and you're just left with awareness. So as we practice these techniques, we get in touch by and by with our core being, our core consciousness, which in spiritual traditions is often called the soul.
Your pituitary gland does amazing things when you are in meditation. It releases oxytocin, dopamine, relaxin, serotonin, endorphins. Everything good that your body can make is released when you make this spiritual connection. There really is this internal process that we can flip on like a light switch. We can flip on these juices of life if we just take a moment to connect. It doesn't have to be meditation or prayer. It could be going for a walk in nature. But your mind needs to quiet, your breathing needs to slow, and you want to feel that unshakable peace.
We did an amazing study just a little ways back at one of our advanced workshops. We took 120 people and we wanted to measure their circulating cortisol levels and a chemical called immunoglobulin A, or IgA. We put them through 4.5 days of training, and at the end of 4.5 days, we measured to see if there were any epigenetic changes or chemical changes that took place by their internal work. We found that the majority of people's cortisol levels diminished, which means they were no longer in survival, they were no longer stressed. But the relevant thing that happened was that their IgA levels went from about 51.5 to 83, right to the ceiling of what's considered high, and some people were up in the hundreds. Now, IgA is the primary defense against bacteria and viruses. It's greater than any flu shot.
The best part about meditation is it doesn't cost anything. You can do it anywhere, anytime,
just quiet the mind and get rid of that excess mental baggage. But the mind isn't all bad. You can actually use your imagination through visualization to activate a powerful healing response.
What if I told you to do a simple exercise of imagination, to go to your refrigerator, open it up, find a lemon, take the lemon, put it on the cutting board, cut the thing in half, take a look at it, juices welling up, and stick out your tongue and lick it. Your salivary glands would go crazy. And it was all in your imagination. So there's no question that what we imagine can affect our physiology.
For several years, I've been collecting stories, testimonies, interviewing several hundred people who've used visualization as some part of their healing journey. And amazingly, what like 99% of them do is you take an internal picture of illness and convert it into an internal picture of wellness. And that's it. It's illness to wellness. That's it. And they just do it over and over and over again. So to give you a few examples of this strategy of illness to wellness, people who are even getting chemotherapy imagine the chemo drugs as little piranha fish going and nibbling at the tumour. But in their mind's eye, what they're seeing is the tumour getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller until it's gone. People in radiotherapy imagine the radiation like bolts of lightning going pum, 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 and burning chunks out the tumour. But again, tumour's getting smaller and smaller and smaller until it's gone.
Toward the end of the treatment, I was really weak. So Deanne called and she said, do you want to have your session? And I said, I don't think I can make it. I can't really get up. I was just laying down a lot. I couldn't really get up. And so she came to visit me, to give me a session. And when she got there, I was just shaking. So she said, I think you're running a fever. She gave the thermometer and it was 103.5. So she said, we need to take you to the hospital. So she drove me to the hospital and it was going up as we're driving. I got to the emergency room and they started giving antibiotic bags after another and nothing was working. I just remember I could hear my heartbeat. It was like I could hear water and air really loud. The fever kept going up and I kind of thought, oh, I wonder if this is it. When I woke up, my brother was standing outside the glass door with the laptop and he was telling me, they're praying for you. They did a group prayer on Facebook with over 100 people, and right after that, I kind of came out.
How could my prayer, how could my meditation, how could my loving thoughts of gratitude and appreciation possibly impact the healing of another person in the room with me or halfway around the world? And the answer is that we are deeply connected through a phenomenon that is known as entanglement. Entanglement is the term in physics that tells us once something is unified, once something begins as a whole, even though it is separated physically by many miles or light years, is what they're finding in the cosmos, energetically everything's still connected. Why is that important? Because if we go back far enough in time, there was a point in time when you, me, and the Earth were all connected before what is called the Big Bang, the big release of energy. When that happened, physically, particles began to separate. Energetically, the particles remain connected. We are part of this Earth, and we are part of one another. And that empowers you, and it empowers me to participate in the healing of our bodies and those of our loved ones in ways that science is only beginning to understand.
So entanglement explains scientifically how our prayers might work. But there's a whole aspect of faith and prayer that can't be explained through science. People travel all over the world to holy sites to receive energy or faith healing. Is it their unshakable belief in God's power and therefore the placebo effect that is responsible for the healing? Or is there an actual divine energy that is causing their transformation? Either way, I'm fascinated by the mystical. And if faith healing works for people, why not respect the possibility and keep an open mind?
So let me just tell you a little bit about me, okay, because you might be a little curious. I was born into a very religious family. We were taught to pray, right? We were taught to ask God for help. So what I learned as a child was that if you trust, if you ask God and you trust and you believe, and then you get out of the way, then anything's possible.
I have a brain tumor called a meningioma, and there is no cure for it, so you're constantly wondering what's going on inside of your head, is it growing, and you know, you have things like that. And you know, a little bit of fear because you don't know if the thing's gonna explode and grow faster.
So please understand I'm not doing anything. Please understand that everything that you'll see happen is coming from the divine. There are no spirit guides or no entities. I'm just grateful that for whatever reason, the divine has chosen me to work through. Let all that stuff go. Let me have all of it, every last bit of it. Let me have it. Shake your head, shake your hand, shake everything out. New hairdo.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Doing okay, brother?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You came in here wanting this, whatever's going on with you, to be gone, and so they're taking that as a...
I'm tingling.
Yeah.
I'm vibrating.
So you look different?
Wow.
Nice work.
My face was like on fire, so to speak. It was electrical current and pulse, but it went throughout my whole body. And when I stood up, I was shaking, but it was a good shake. It was different. I've never felt anything like this in my life.
Hoo-wee, man. Holy shit. Hoo-wee. Hoo-wee. Shit.
You see, this is why I get up in the morning, right here. I mean, all of you, but this is like the perfect, like, you see what's possible.
Oh, my God.
What are you noticing in your body so far?
I thought it would be really hard to let go because I don't know who I am without being sick.
Yeah, well, and?
I feel like I'm trying to.
You're doing it, girl. You're not trying, you're doing. Big difference. Let it go. What she just said is like the bottom line with so many people. They don't know what it's gonna be like, what it would be like to be well, and it's scary, so they don't go there.
People say, well, I don't have faith. But actually, everyone has faith of some kind. You either have faith in possibility or you have faith that that possibility doesn't exist. And in a way, we have more faith in the power of cancer to kill us than we have faith in the power of God, the power of miracles, the power of infinite possibility, the power of any force other than what our eyes can see and our hands can touch to actually interrupt the power and the trajectory of disease.
I had no idea what was coming, you know. I was just trying to prepare myself for whatever answer they gave me. And Deanne took me into the appointment, and the oncologist said, well, your scans came back all clear.
No cancer!
And I just started crying and laughing at the same time, and he said, yeah, we must have misdiagnosed you.
What?
Yeah, well, I think because he didn't think it could be resolved so quickly.
It's a miracle. It's a miracle.
The
regimen always was with everyone. They said it'll be a two-year thing. It'll be chemo first, then chemo radiation, then surgery, then more chemo, and that would take 2 years. And mine was gone in one round.
Where did we do it last time? We did it at Resolution.
And even my oncologist, who I thought was the best of the that I could find, they'd say, wow, it's amazing. All of your hair hasn't come out. What are you doing? You look really good. Your numbers are good and stuff. And I said, I'm doing wheatgrass. And he'd go, okay, well, whatever. And I said, do you not believe in wheatgrass? And he said, no, you know, but if it makes you feel better. They gave me two different types, and with the one, my hair would have come out completely. But with the two, yeah, for sure, it was a goner. And it never all came out. I still had a good two-thirds of it at the end.
Yeah, all the time in the world to enjoy it.
The best part for me was that I was supported by friends and family, and that I had a spiritual therapist that really helped me work through all of this stuff and get rid of the fear and the old hurts and wounds, and then allow me to return to a really high state of healing.
If you perceive that people are coming to help you and hold you and help you through this process, and you feel this outpouring of love, they are actually helping your body heal. Because as soon as you perceive that, as soon as you believe that people are sending you love, you have this oxytocin response. And oxytocin release has been associated with increased natural killer cells, increased white cells. You know, the immune response just goes through the roof.
It's really important to work with doctors that treat you as a whole person and surround yourself with friends that inspire hope and strengthen you rather than add to your fear. It's hard though, because when I'm sick or in pain, I feel vulnerable and just want to crawl up in a ball and be alone. So how do we break out of that downward spiral of fear? How do we transcend the pain and shift to a positive mindset?
So when a person shows up in a doctor's office and they're given the diagnosis of rheumatoid arthritis or MS or cancer or diabetes, once they hear that diagnosis, the common emotions they experience is either fear or sadness. They can think positively all they want. They can say, I'm going to overcome this condition. But if they are feeling fear, that thought never makes it past the brainstem into the body because it's not in alignment with the body's emotional state. You get that person to change their emotional state and get them into a state of gratitude. Why gratitude? Well, we normally give thanks when we get something. But if you're giving thanks in a state of gratitude, your body is believing it's receiving something because the emotional signature of gratitude means it's already happened.
So the more that we can feel the feeling as if our healing has already occurred, giving thanks for that healing already being present, that is the trigger for our bodies to grow the nerve cells to make the connections to trigger the brain chemistry to reflect that healing. We have this advanced nervous system that we regulate through the choices we make in our lives, what we think, what we feel, what we believe, and specifically the emotions that we choose to respond to what life brings to our doorstep.
You know, I've been trying not to take the steroids.
Yes.
So I went through a small breakout last month, which I thought was good. And then it was kind of just, you know, dormant, like it never really went away. And then all of a sudden just exploded over the weekend.
Oh.
So I have like these massive boils that are starting, and then I have them all over my chest.
Oh. Oh my God.
Yeah.
So that's like,
this is like when it's almost full blown, it's not quite.
So if you have something residing in you, like say you have Epstein-Barr virus, or say you have one of the shingles viruses, stress can trigger it. Mold can trigger it. Someone breaking your trust can trigger it. Problems at work can trigger it. Being fired from your job, everything can trigger it. But there has to be something in there to trigger. The key is knowing what the real cause is so you can live life like a normal person and have things go wrong and not go down because of it.
Okay, so my little flower blossoms are turning into big dahlias.
They're starting to merge together and get really huge and extremely painful and hot, constantly burning up and then getting the chills. Powered through today. They immediately called some doctors and put me in isolation because they didn't know if it was, you know, contagious, viral, what was going on, infectious.
And some really bad abdominal pains, and just this is just getting so painful and intense.
So they called all those specialists and they ran all these tests and everything came back basically normal. You know, as I got out, they gave me just really heavy doses of steroids to knock it out because they could see that I wasn't getting better on its own. And then my dermatologist was concerned about me taking the steroids after to initially knock out the breakout. So she gave me a prescription of Dapsone, which is an antibiotic. And I didn't realize the strength of the antibiotic until I went to the pharmacist. He stopped me at the counter and said, do you know that this is a really heavy dose of antibiotic that you're taking? So that's where I'm at. You know, I have to pick my poison. Do I band-aid it with steroids or do I take this heavy antibiotic indefinitely? Being in LA and going to some of the best doctors in their field and probably seeing half a dozen to a dozen doctors now, nobody can figure it out. They give me drugs for all these different things that they think it may be. But I mean, that's kind of the process with Western medicine. It's very difficult because it's just, let's just throw everything at it and, you know, which one Velcro's the best.
Do you think that if alternative doctors were covered by insurance, you might go more often or they might seem more credible?
Definitely, because I know with steroids, it's very easy. It's $5, I get it, and I'm better. If I could get access to these vitamins and to these alternative doctors at those nominal costs, then I would probably go much more often. I believe in the naturopath and all that and doing everything that's alternative. I just can't seem to dedicate myself. I don't know why. You know, maybe I'm just, you know, emotionally stunted to do or open myself up to that, or there's just something that's blocking me. Because it seems achievable, and in my condition, like, I should be able to, but for some reason, I can't.
Eva made me realize how much courage and sometimes cost it takes to commit to a holistic path of healing. As a society, we've been conditioned to believe that conventional doctors know best and that convenience is key. For me, though, it's either pay now or pay later, and I really fear the long-term effects the steroids will have on Eva's body. But I truly understand her struggle, so all I can do is continue to support her in any way I can and pray she finds an answer soon.
It's around your third anniversary being cancer-free. Some fear comes up around this time of year because you've heard stories.
Oh, so many. When I first went back to work, they'd say, oh, great to have you back. And then say, yeah, my so-and-so had cancer. And then, oh, they were great. They did the chemo, and then they had no cancer for 2 years. And then 2.5 years later, they're all covered with cancer. They died months later. So many stories like that. So I've been kind of dreading this PET scan. And also, I don't like the radiation. But you have to do it. I actually was manifesting a lot of pain in my body. And then you can't tell whether it's from the radiation damage or what's going on. But yeah, it got to the point where I thought for sure it was coming back. What seems very, very clear to me is that my body wants to be healthy. Our bodies want to be healthy, but it's the head that just, it's the fear and the this and the whatever that wants to, you know, it's just like a racket. You're running on yourself, kind of. Mm-hmm. And how to let go of that.
What is your one takeaway message that you want to share with everybody?
Well, I would say that the most powerful moment The one when I had the largest epiphany was toward the end of the chemo and radiation. I was really weak, and I told my brother I just wanted to go to the beach and I wanted to be in the sun. So he carried me and laid me in the grass. And then he went out on the beach, and I was just laying there looking at everybody. And I was watching people rollerblade and bicycle and walk with each other and laugh. And I just wished I could have told each of those people, you're so fortunate. It occurred to me that this life is, it's as beautiful or as terrible as you make it. And we have so much beauty and opportunity around us. I just wish I could let you all know what an amazing gift it is to be alive.
Focus on life. Focus on something that brings you joy. Focus on love. Focus on your loved ones. And spend every day doing things that make you feel good. When I usually tell people who've been told that they're in remission, I say, think of the word remission as actually meaning remember my mission. So now it's time for you to go and remember your mission.
Disease can be complicated, painful, and scary. I don't claim to have all the answers, but on this journey, I have learned that the human body is capable of miraculous things. It is an intelligent system deeply connected to our minds and the world around us, and brilliantly designed to self-regulate and heal. By detoxing our environment, the air we breathe, the food we eat, the water we drink, and the products we use, we support the healing process. And as we go beyond the physical and improve our inner environment, our thoughts, beliefs, and emotions, we can shift our lives and health in powerful ways. And it's all about faith, whether it's faith in God, faith in medicine, faith in our body's ability to heal, or a combination of all three. If we believe it, we can achieve it. We live in a world of infinite possibility. Choose and focus on the possibility that you want. Don't get sucked into the fear of what you don't want. We have the power to heal.
So tap me out and tap me into you. Heal my brain and my body too. Balance my chemistry, hydrate these cells, 'cause the body talks and meditation helps. The body talks and meditation helps.
If I could get people to realize how precious they are, they're an expression of life. There's no other you out there. That's 1 in 8 billion, that's pretty special. But I guarantee you, most people don't give themselves that kind of love and care. That would be a wonderful precursor to healing.
The better we know ourselves, the better equipped we are to heal our bodies, to heal our emotions, to heal the inner experience that allows us to love to the deepest degree in the outer world.
Educate yourself about the mind-body connection, because your mind exerts an extraordinarily powerful impact on your body 24 hours a day, 365 days a year.
Every day, I meet someone who beat incredible odds and turned around stage 4 cancer. Healing can really happen at any time, even when you're at quote-unquote death's door.
And ultimately go beyond your fear of death, because death happens to an experience, not to you.
It's my expectation that this will become more and more compelling to more and more people as we all grow together into a different kind of medicine.
Rather than this being something that you just read in a book or you watch in a documentary, put it into action. Fall down, get back up, fall down, get back up. Reach out to other people. Ask them their stories. Don't ever give up.
Your body loves you. It loves you unconditionally, and it's not letting you down. Have patience. Have compassion. Take one day at a time. You're gonna get there. Doesn't matter how long you've been sick. You can heal, and always remember that and never forget it.
I speak the word, knowing that from this moment on, everything is working together for our individual and collective good, and that we claim our wholeness right now. We claim our health right now. We claim our vitality and our vigor and the power to rejuvenate and regenerate right now. Something wonderful is happening. And we let it be. Now and forever, and so it is.